Thank you very much, and thank you for the invitation to come to this marvellous event. So it's wonderful to celebrate anniversaries and to look back over 100 years of history, and superconductivity is a remarkable property. When you think about it and you think about other things which are called super, you have this feeling of a property which is extraordinary, marvellous, and doing something which ordinary conductivity just can't do, just as if it was leaping over tall buildings. Where does the energy come from? How can it possibly do that? And the discovery, of course, we're celebrating 100 years ago, was made by Kamling Onnes, working in Leiden. Now, I think it's important to realise that Kamling Onnes, his whole career was not aimed at discovering superconductivity. It was a complete accident. His quest had been to liquefy helium. And throughout the 19th century, various different gases were liquefied progressively. And the temperature that you could obtain went lower and lower, but helium stubbornly refused to liquefy. It was the one thing you couldn't do after it had, of course, been discovered in some point in the mid-19th century on the sun, which is how it gets its name, Helios, helium. And Onnes was in a race against James Dewar working at the Royal Institution. And Onnes's success was that he realised that you needed technicians. He trained technicians, he had an army of them, he had an extremely well-organised lab, whereas I think James Dewar was essentially one man with a tweed jacket and a pipe. And so there was really no contest. But it took decades of investment in doing this, and in 1908, helium was liquefied, and that was the key achievement. And he was motivated in doing this by another Dutch scientist, van der Waals, who was a theorist. Here's Onnes with van der Waals standing next to him. And van der Waals was a theorist working on how you understand and model gases when they get cold enough that they liquefy. And so the whole motivation of Onnes's work was to try and verify theory, try and test van der Waals's theory. And to do that, he needed to go to low temperatures. Now, once he'd liquefied helium, the question is, what can you do with this new technology? And whenever you develop a new technology, a whole vista opens up. So one of the questions that Onnes was then able to do, now as a sort of side product, was to try and understand what the resistance of metals did when you cool them down. And there were various possible theories. One idea was that it just tends to zero as you cool down. It was known that the resistance falls as you cool. Another possibility is that the resistance could saturate and become a flat value. And this, in fact, experimentally was found to be the case in many metals due to impurity scattering, because no sample can be made perfectly pure. Kelvin thought that what would happen is that the electrons would freeze out and the resistance would shoot up to infinity. So here was a clear test. You could do some experiments. The early measurements, as I said, showed this sort of behavior, but that was because the samples weren't sufficiently pure. So Onnes needed a really, really pure metal, and he hit on the idea of using mercury. Mercury is a liquid. You could therefore repeatedly distill it, get all of the rubbish out, get a really pure sample, cool it down, and do the experiment. So here is some of the data. Here you can see the resistance of gold just flattening off, and here is a modern version of Onnes's data. So the resistance falls more sharply, and then suddenly at around 4 Kelvin, something extraordinary happens. The resistance completely disappears. And this wasn't either of any of the three possibilities that had been suggested. It was something entirely surprising, and this new phenomenon had been discovered. Of course, very shortly afterwards, Onnes discovered that he needn't have spended, or rather his technicians needn't have spended, months purifying mercury. It works just as well with dirty mercury. You see the effect. And a year later, in 1912, he discovered the effect in tin and lead and went through trying to find out more metals that superconducted. This is where they got to in 1920. In 1930, more superconducting elements had been found. By 1950, the periodic table had started to get filled out. And in fact, if you look at a modern version of this periodic table of superconducting elements, you can see that superconductivity is creeping over the whole of the periodic table. The black elements are those that superconduct under normal conditions, ambient conditions, if you like, just you have to get them cold enough. The grey ones are the ones that you can get to go superconducting if you put a sufficient amount of pressure or make them in film form or do some particular process to them. And in fact, there's an idea that maybe almost all things will go superconducting, maybe absolutely everything will go to superconducting if you get it into the right condition. Well, this is a whistle-tops tour of the history of superconductivity, and the next big breakthrough was in the early 1930s, the discovery in Berlin of the Meissner-Ochsenfeld effect. And really, I think we now understand this to be the fundamental property of superconductors. Although they're named for having zero resistance, the fact that they levitate and, more crucially, expel magnetic fields is an absolutely crucial feature of superconductors. As we're in Britain, I want to mention a particular British contribution that was made by two brothers in Oxford, Fritz London and Heinz London. They were working there in the period of 1934 to 1936. They were both born in Breslau in what's now Germany, and they'd had to get out of various academic positions in Germany because they were both Jewish. And they were brought over by Lord Charwell, Frederick Lindemann, who brought out a whole lot of scientists from Germany. Here are some of the people that ended up in Oxford because of his rather aggressive ability to bring these people out and give them safe haven. Not all of them stayed in Oxford for very long. Albert Einstein only stayed for a very short period. Schrödinger stayed for a few years. But all of these people, including Nicholas Curti, who was at one point Martin Wood's boss, came to Oxford through this period. And Fritz London, as a theorist, was also brought over. And the two brothers worked on something called the London theory in the 1930s. Now, I just want to explain a little bit about what superconductivity is and give you a very simple picture that I think illustrates the key of London's ideas. Take a black box. You don't know what's in it, but we're not going to allow you to plug it into the main, so there's no power source. So you've just got this black box. And you can do measurements around the black box, and you discover that the black box emits magnetic fields, but I haven't told you what's in it. So you can make some guesses, and one idea you might come up with is what's inside the black box is a bar magnet, and that's producing the magnetic field. But from the early 19th century, it was realised that another possibility could be that it could be an artificial magnet, if you like, a coil with a battery, a power source. And this is the idea of ampere in the early 19th century, artificial magnetism. But if you wanted to do an experiment with the black box and tell the difference, there's one way you can tell the difference between natural magnetism from a magnet and artificial magnetism. Wait 2 weeks, the battery will have run down, and there'll be no more magnetic field, and that's the way you tell the difference. Now, so that's the way you can tell the difference between these two situations. Now, of course, what we have in an atom is we have another type of current. As was realised at the beginning of the 20th century, the electrons don't spiral into the atom. They go round in these perfect orbits, stately as a galleon. And what London realised was that superconductivity was rather like this right-hand case. It was almost as if a superconductor is behaving like a giant atom. So now, in fact, we can realise that there's a third possibility of what's going on in this box. It could be a superconducting current, a persistent current carrying on forever. And what you realise when you consider these three situations is that the superconductor with persistent current is more similar to the bar magnet than it is to the artificial magnet. In other words, it behaves like a giant atom. It has this peculiar property of quantum coherence that keeps it going, just like you have in an atom. And Edith London described the moment in the 1930s when the breakthrough of the two London brothers was made. They called her down downstairs. Edith, come, we have it. They were working in an upstairs room. She raced up and ended up banging her head on the door as it was opened in her face, had a bruise for a week. But Fritz had said, the equations are established, we have the solution, we can explain it. And this was the key idea behind what's going on in superconductivity and allowed the Londons to make a remarkable prediction. They realised that if you take a supercurrent going around a superconductor around a hole, then because this is a quantum coherent effect, in other words, the phase is well defined all the way around the loop, it can be linked to the number of magnetic flux quanta going through the hole. And this prediction back in the 1930s and early 1940s eventually led to measurements of flux quantization that were done in the early 1960s and allowed the deduction of the fact that in superconductivity you have pairing, two electrons pairing together giving you superconductivity. And in the late 1980s, this effect was done by the Birmingham group for the new high-temperature superconductors, again showing you that pairing is what's involved, two charges coming together and giving you superconductivity. Well, of course, lots of, I'm going at great speed, but one of the key developments that was made in superconductivity was the BCS theory made by three American physicists, Bardeen, Cooper and Schrieffer, in the late 1950s. And in fact, if you want to see the state of the art of what was going on in superconductivity in the late 1950s, just before the 50th anniversary of superconductivity, you should consult Lord May's thesis, which he's brought with him tonight. He did his thesis, many of you may not know, on superconductivity. Now, what the BCS theory essentially tells you is that superconductivity involves a very strange, unlikely pairing effect between two repulsive entities that mutually repel each other and yet nevertheless are bound together in this particular state. And if you want another analogy, I particularly tell this one to students who particularly get into this. The Terminator films, if any of you have seen this, involve a robot from the future that marches with destruction. You can blow it up. All the bits zoom out, but they coalesce together. And whatever you do to it, however you try and blow the robot up, it coalesces and carries on marching. And in much the same way, the supercurrent, it scatters all the time. The pairs are constantly scattering, but they always scatter into another state that has the same momentum. And so the supercurrent carries on rolling towards you. Well, just to bring the story up to date a little bit, this is a graph of superconducting transition temperature against year of discovery. And you can see that as more discoveries were made over this long period, TC increased. But something rather remarkable happened in the 1980s. As I just blow this graph up, you can see the extraordinary effects that were discovered in the late 1980s with the high TC superconductors. And Oxford Instruments founded here, so you can see where on the timeline the development of superconducting magnets came. And one of the rather remarkable things is actually it took 50 years for the technology to be developed to the point where you could commercialize it. And I think that's a very important lesson, because Onis realized he could make superconducting magnets, but the critical fields were way too low, and it took 50 years of intensive science before you could commercialize that. And that's something I think our politicians need to understand, the timescales involved. But the high-temperature superconductors discovered by Bednors and Muller, based on these rather strange oxide systems, have had a huge impact in the theory of superconductivity, because we really don't understand how they work. They don't follow the BCS theory, and so this is still an active area of research. Here you can see that when you make a really big discovery of something like the high TCs, it involves politicians, Ronald Reagan desperately trying to understand what's going on in the demonstration, I think. And very recently, new discoveries are still being made. I think if you'd asked me 3 or 4 years ago, could you have a superconductor involving iron, I would have said it's impossible, because iron is a pair breaker, it's magnetic. And now these new superconductors have been discovered in the last 2 or 3 years. We're working on them in Oxford, based on their funny name, pinnictides, but they have iron in them and arsenic. And they are providing a whole new way of understanding superconductors and developing new materials. So this is a whistle-stop tour of the history of superconductivity, 100 years going very fast. And yet I hope you can see, looking back over this 100 years, progress has been steady. New developments have been made all of the time, and yet technology does take a long time to develop, and those timescales are needed. And perhaps in 100 years' time, it'll be interesting to look back to see what we've done in the next 100 years. Thank you very much.